This morning we are continuing our study of Judges, and we're looking at Judges chapter 3, beginning at verse 7, and that can be found on page 244 of the Church Bibles. Judges chapter 3, beginning at verse 7. The Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. They forgot the Lord their God and served the Baals and the Asherahs. The anger of the Lord burned against Israel so that he sold them into the hands of Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Aram-Naharaim, to whom the Israelites were subject for 8 years. But when they cried out to the Lord, he raised up for them a deliverer, Othniel, son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother, who saved them. The Spirit of the Lord came upon him, so that he became Israel's judge and went to war. The Lord gave Cushan-Rishathaim, king of Aram, into the hands of Othniel, who overpowered him. So the land had peace for 40 years, until Othniel, son of Kenaz, died. Once again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. And because they did this evil, the Lord gave Eglon, king of Moab, power over Israel. Getting the Ammonites and Amalekites to join him, Eglon came and attacked Israel, and they took possession of the city of Palms. The Israelites were subject to Eglon, king of Moab, for 18 years. Again, the Israelites cried out to the Lord, and he gave them a deliverer, Ehud, a left-handed man, the son of Gera the Benjamite. The Israelites sent him with tribute to Eglon, king of Moab. Now Ehud had made a double-edged sword about a foot and a half long, which he strapped to his right thigh under his clothing. He presented the tribute to Eglon, king of Moab, who was a very fat man. After Ehud had presented the tribute, he sent on their way the men who had carried it. At the idols near Gilgal, he himself turned back and said, "I have a secret message for you, O king." The king said, "Quiet," and all his attendants left him. Ehud then approached him while he was sitting alone in the upper room of his summer palace and said, "I have a message from God for you." As the king rose from his seat, Ehud reached with his left hand, drew the sword from his right thigh, and plunged it into the king's belly. Even the handle sank in after the blade, which came out of his back. Ehud did not pull the sword out, and the fat closed in over it. Then Ehud went out to the porch. He shut the doors of the upper room behind him and locked them. After he had gone, the servants came and found the doors of the upper room locked. They said, "He must be relieving himself in the inner room of the house." They waited to the point of embarrassment, but when he did not open the doors of the room, they took a key and unlocked them. There they saw their lord fallen to the floor, dead. While they waited, Ehud got away. He passed by the idols and escaped to Seirah. When he arrived there, he blew a trumpet in the hill country of Ephraim, and the Israelites went down with him from the hills, with him leading them. "Follow me," he ordered, "for the Lord has given Moab, your enemy, into your hands." So they followed him down, and taking possession of the fords of the Jordan that led to Moab, they allowed no one to cross over. At that time, they struck down about 10,000 Moabites, all vigorous and strong. Not a man escaped. That day, Moab was made subject to Israel, and the land had peace for 80 years. After Ehud came Shamgar, son of Anath, who struck down 600 Philistines with an ox goad. He too saved Israel.
Elizabeth, thanks very much for reading. Great to see you all this morning. Every Sunday at the moment feels like kind of one more step out of COVID. And we've got a long way to go. And I know it's strange perhaps for some of us. Maybe you come on a Sunday and you just think lots of new faces. Maybe you still don't quite feel like you belong, as it were. It takes time, doesn't it, to reconnect, to come back. And can I say, if that's you, then our vision dinners, they are a really precious opportunity to reconnect as a community. We'd love to see you. If you haven't yet booked, still undecided, you've got one more day to book. And it'd just be great, wouldn't it, for us to gather. And it's a great opportunity just to reconnect. Do keep that Bible passage open in front of you. I'm going to pray and we're going to ask for the Lord's help as we try and understand what on earth is going on here. Let's pray. Father God, we come this morning maybe with heavy hearts or anxious hearts. Some of us will be grieving. Some of us will be weary. Some of us will be full of thanks and praise and joy at the chance to gather. Some of us will feel maybe very distant in a sea of new faces. But Father, for all of us, you speak to us now through your word. And so we ask for that work of your Spirit to soften our hearts, to open our eyes, that we would see more of who you are. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, here is a passage that has basically everything: drama, suspense, deception, quite a lot of killing. A really fat man, I mean really fat, some toilet humour, don't always get that on a Sunday morning in church, and some bloke called Shamgar, who only gets one line, but he still managed to kill 600 Philistines with what was basically a cattle prod. You wouldn't want to kind of get on the wrong side of Shamgar. So what is going on here? Well, it's certainly not dull, but it is quite messy. And yet in the mess, God is at work. So if this morning your life is a little bit messy, if sometimes your relationships feel strained, if there are things in your past that you're not very proud of, if you're looking for forgiveness for the things you've got wrong, if you struggle with pride, or if you're just searching for hope right now in the midst of grief, if you've grown cold in your walk with Jesus, then this passage this morning, here, now, is for you, because it shows us a God who works in our mess, a God who takes people who, spiritually speaking, are not very promising, and he saves them because he loves them. Here in chapter 3, we meet the first three judges raised up by God to save his people: Othniel, Ehud, and Shamgar. Remember, Joshua has led the people of Israel across the River Jordan into the promised land, the land of Canaan. And Judges is telling the story of what happens when Israel takes over the land after Joshua has died. And we saw last week there's a kind of repeating cycle in which the people of Israel commit the sin of idolatry. So verse 7, they did evil in the eyes of the Lord. So rebellion. Because of that, verse 8, the anger of the Lord burned against them, so he sold them into the hands of Cushan-Rishathaim. So retribution. Cushan-Rishathaim, by the way, literally means Cushan double wickedness. It's kind of a sort of cartoon name in the Old Testament, a sort of Dick Dastardly or Dr. Evil from the Austin Powers movies. If you have no idea what I'm referring to when I talk about the Austin Powers movies, that is vastly to your credit. Forget that I mentioned it and we'll move on. But the storyteller is telling us something here. And under their oppressors, under Dr. Evil, verse 9, the people cried out to the Lord in repentance. Next bit of the cycle. Because of that, the Lord then raised up for them a deliverer who saved them. Rescue. And in verse 11, the land had peace for 40 years. Rest. But as we're about to see, the cycle then repeats itself. And it gets worse. And although Othniel doesn't appear to have any weaknesses at all, from Ehud onwards, all the judges we meet are imperfect. In fact, as the book unfolds, each rebellion is basically worse than the previous one. The suffering lasts for longer, and the judges each time are increasingly flawed. A downward spiral, and yet somehow, in all of it, God is at work. And we're going to look today at Ehud and at what his story tells us about God's salvation. So here's the first thing we see. God's salvation comes to an undeserving people. Read with me from verse 12. Once again, the Israelites did evil in the eyes of the Lord. And because they did this evil, the Lord gave Eglon, king of Moab, power over Israel. Getting the Ammonites and Amalekites to join him, Eglon came and attacked Israel, and they took possession of the city of Palms. So Othniel dies, the cycle repeats, and this time the Israelites suffer for even longer, 18 years, rather than just 8 years previously. So it's getting worse. And it was a brutal regime. They were heavily taxed. Eglon, quite literally, took a slice of everything. Even in a good year, the farmers knew that any profits would be thin because Eglon and his mates were busy getting fat off whatever they produced. But life under the old covenant was very simple. Obedience brought covenant blessings. Disobedience brought covenant curses. And Israel had done evil in the eyes of the Lord. So there are no surprises here. Deuteronomy 28, Leviticus 26, God says, if you turn away from me, don't expect to enjoy my favor. So what is the evil in verse 12 of which the Israelites are guilty? Well, verse 7 is actually really helpful here looking back because it tells us a bit more. And it's two things. Have a look, verse 7. They forgot the Lord their God and they served the Baals and the Asherahs. So they turned away from the one true God to worship the gods of the people around them. And to say that Israel forgot here is not a statement about the head. It's a statement about the heart. You see, it's not that Israel forgot the actual events as God saved them out of Egypt and took them into the promised land. You know, in the pub quiz every week, in the Exodus round, they would win it every time. They knew all the stories. It's just that they were no longer controlled by what they knew. They were doing, do you do this? They were doing what we do. I do this. Where we know in our heads what God has done for us, but it's no longer real in our hearts. We know the truths of the gospel, don't we? Christ died to set us free from sin and death because he loves us. But spiritually, we grow cold. We no longer taste it. We no longer feel these truths in the everyday. The grace of God is no longer what controls us and shapes us and drives us because we're consumed by the gods of the world around us. And to demonstrate just how bad it has got for Israel, notice first the geography. So Eglon, we are told here, has taken over Jericho. That's the city of Palms. The same Jericho that Israel took down in Joshua chapter 6 with basically not much more than a jazz band. So the scene, just picture it, the scene of one of Israel's greatest victories, a symbol of God's power, a fortress on the map, has fallen to fat King Eglon and his greedy friends. If you're a cricket fan here, that is like Australia losing a test match at the Gabba. In rugby, that is like beating New Zealand in New Zealand. It just doesn't happen. So when it does, it is a national disaster. So the geography and then the scenery. In verse 19 and verse 26, twice we're told that Ehud passes the idols near Gilgal. That's on the eastern border of Jericho. It's the place where God dried up the River Jordan so that Israel could enter Canaan on dry ground, Joshua chapter 4. And when Israel crossed over that day, the Lord told them to take 12 stones from the riverbed, one for each tribe. And they laid the stones there at Gilgal as a reminder for their children of what God had done that day to take them into the promised land. The stones were signs there to tell the story of God's grace. But the hearts of God's people have now grown cold. And Gilgal has become a shrine now to other gods. You see, sin is spiritual amnesia. The Israelites forgot what God had done to save them. And we do the same, don't we? For many of us, we're spiritually dry at the moment, aren't we? Because the pandemic has turned our lives upside down and it has pulled us away from church. One of the symptoms of COVID is loss of taste. I think for many of us, we've struggled to taste, haven't we, the goodness of God, the grace of God in our lives day by day over the past year. Spiritually, we've gone cold. We just can't taste it anymore. But as we get back into the habit of meeting together every Sunday, we are remembering what God has done for us, even though we don't deserve it. We are rediscovering what it is like to taste the goodness of God in our lives. We'll be doing that at the Vision Dinners later this week. And it's so important that we gather week by week in church because we want to celebrate God's grace together. Why? Because if we don't, we'll forget. Without each other, without our Sundays, we forget. We're not worthy of his love. But wonderfully, God's salvation comes to an undeserving people. That's the first thing. Then the second, God's salvation comes through an unlikely leader. Verse 15, again the Israelites cried out to the Lord and he gave them a deliverer, Ehud, a left-handed man, the son of Gera, the Benjamite. The Israelites sent him with tributes to Eglon, king of Moab. Now, given that Benjamin means son of my right hand, it is somewhat unfortunate for Ehud that he is left-handed. In the Bible, the right hand was a symbol of power, strength, ability. In battle, you fought with your right hand. The Lord swears by his right hand. The Son sits at the right hand of the Father. Othniel, he was a warrior from the faithful tribe of Judah. Basically, Othniel was classic headboy material. In fact, Othniel doesn't appear to have any weaknesses at all. But Ehud, he's the kid who gets picked last every time in playground football. Okay? If God is raising up a deliverer for his people, you would ask, how on earth can a lefty be the right man for the job? You just wouldn't go with a guy like Ehud. In our family, we've quite enjoyed the Johnny English films over the years. I don't know if you know them. They're kind of sort of James Bond spoof. You know, Rowan Atkinson as the sort of hapless secret agent who somehow saves the day when he's completely clueless and so on. It's sort of Mr. Bean meets 007. At a time when Israel needs a James Bond, Ehud is Johnny English. He is, in every sense, an unlikely leader, an unlikely hero. And yet, in the wonderful sovereignty of God, that is why he is able to save the day. You see, if he can't wield a sword with his right hand, it's a pretty safe bet that he can't wield a sword at all. It's no accident here that God's chosen leader is left-handed. You see, nobody's going to look for a sword strapped to the right thigh under his clothing. So when the king says to his bodyguards in verse 19, please give us the room, they're not going to worry about leaving Eglon all alone with Ehud. I mean, it's Ehud. He's not a threat. He's left-handed. He's unarmed. Can't do anything. But of course, whilst he appears to be unarmed, the truth is, the sword has been specially made to fit his left hand and his clothing. And of course, whilst Ehud appears to come with a message from God for Eglon, the truth is, he's actually there to take him down. Ehud is, in every way, an unlikely leader. And he points us to the most unlikely leader of all. Because this judge, Ehud, points us to the judge, Jesus Christ. Like Ehud, the Lord Jesus achieved his victory all alone. When he went to the cross to die in our place, Jesus did so on behalf of his people as our representative, and he did it in place of his people as our substitute. But he also did it without his people. We were of no help to him at the cross because we have nothing to offer to pay for our sin, nothing to contribute towards our salvation. Like Ehud, Jesus saved his people not through human strength and Hollywood power, but through weakness. Jesus raised his arms not to fight, but to die. And he did it for you and me, not because we deserve it, but out of love. And then, like Ehud, Jesus was an outsider. The world simply could not accept that he was God's anointed ruler. The prophet Isaiah said of him, he had nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men. The world despises Jesus because it simply cannot believe that a carpenter from Galilee could be God's anointed leader. There is nothing impressive about that. It is completely left-handed. And we shouldn't be surprised, therefore. Here is an encouragement for you if you're one of the messy ones. I think that's all of us, by the way. Here's the encouragement. We shouldn't be surprised when an unlikely leader has an unlikely following. Let's be honest, the 12 disciples weren't exactly Ivy League. They did let him down a little bit. One of them betrayed him. Another denied even knowing him. There was quite a lot of mess. But they did get the church up and running. 2,000 years on, we're still here. Companies fall in and out of the FTSE 100, but the worldwide movement that is the local church continues. And we are an unlikely bunch. Underneath our Sunday best, we're not very impressive. We're forgetful. We suffer from some pretty serious bouts of spiritual amnesia. We're idolatrous. Instead of worshipping the God who saved us, we pour ourselves out for material things. We make a mess of our relationships. We fail quite a lot. This is just my CV, by the way. If you want to come and tell me over coffee, that's yours as well. I'd be very grateful. That would be a pastoral blessing to me this morning. But can you see what's going on here? God uses us, to build his kingdom. And he works through our mess. Because he's a God of grace. And he wants us to see that our salvation is all from him and not our own human effort. So God's salvation comes to an undeserving people through an unlikely leader. And it comes, finally, in an unexpected victory. If you think about it, a truckload of tribute is the perfect cover for Ehud's mission. We're told that King Eglon was a very fat man, verse 17. Essentially, no stranger to an all-you-can-eat buffet, if you know what I mean. So his eyes light up when Ehud arrives with all that lovely produce. And although we might question the ethics of deception and a cold-blooded killing, it is the Lord, in verse 15, who appointed him as Israel's deliverer. He is not a rogue actor taking matters into his own hands. He is God's leader, delivering God's justice for God's people against God's enemies. We're not to copy what he does, but nor are we to question it. And it's so clever, this, that in the upper room of the palace, the kind of inner sanctum, Eglon just does not see it coming. You see, he's complacent enough to believe that Ehud is harmless, hence no security. And he is vain enough to believe that God really does have a message that is just for him. And here's how it all plays out. Have a look at verse 20. Ehud says to him, "I have a message from God for you." As the king rose from his seat, Ehud reached with his left hand and drew the sword from his right thigh and plunged it into the king's belly. You want a word from the Lord? You want a word? I've got a word. Here's a word. Even the handle, just picture this, even the handle sank in after the blade, which came out of his back. Ehud did not pull the sword out, and the fat closed in over it. Now, I'm not a Hebrew scholar, but you can kind of hear the squelching sound as it goes in and the rolls of fat come around it. Do you know what I mean? And the little phrase came out of his back. It's so wonderfully sort of British, middle class, understated sort of thing. You see, it would be better translated as his bowels discharged, or the dung came out. Basically, in the moment when the sword goes through into his back, Eglon has what you might describe as a pretty significant toilet episode. He is, in every sense here, the butt of the joke. I'm just going to keep rolling out the gags, because here's the thing. It's not just that we're allowed to laugh at it. We're actually meant to. The storyteller here is telling this with a smile because he's enjoying this unexpected victory. He's enjoying this kind of insignificant left-handed Ehud taking down the mighty King Eglon. He was a big man with a big appetite. You can imagine his bowels discharging. And the comedy doesn't end there. What happens next? Well, Ehud leaves. He locks the doors behind him to give himself time to escape. So that after he had gone, this is verse 24, have a look, the servants came and found the doors of the upper room locked. They said he must be relieving himself in the inner room of the house. So a bit like their boss, they're pretty gullible too, easily fooled. He must be on the loo. Verse 25, they waited to the point of embarrassment. I mean, you can imagine them sort of gasping at the smell. You know, probably had the curried goat for lunch, better give it a couple more minutes, that sort of thing. But when he did not open the doors of the room, they took a key and unlocked them. You can imagine that, phoning down to facilities. We need the keys. Someone comes running up, big bunch of keys, takes ages trying to find the right one, smell wafting out, you know, maybe something seeping out under the door. You know, you can see the comedy. And then there it is. They get in. There they saw their Lord fallen to the floor, dead. And it wasn't just blood on the carpet, was it, when they walked in? Ehud by now, well, he's long gone. So with the Moabites having lost their king, he can raise the battle cry. Verse 28, follow me, he ordered, for the Lord has given Moab, your enemy, into your hands. Can you see? It's the Lord who is in charge here. So they followed him down, and taking possession of the fords of Jordan that led to Moab, they allowed no one to cross over. At that time, they struck down about 10,000 Moabites, all vigorous and strong. Not a man escaped. Vigorous and strong, by the way, basically means they really enjoyed their food. You see, the Moabites have grown fat off all that lovely tribute that they have taken from the Israelites. And whilst we laugh at King Eglon and his chubby little army, the truth is for 18 years they have squeezed every last drop out of Israel. That's what our idols do to us. If we worship other gods, they will bleed us dry. They will take and take and take and give nothing back. That is what the Moabites have done to Israel for 18 years. And it's misery. But now the Lord delivers his people from their oppressors. And where Israel's enemy was a foreign king, defeated in the palace and on the battlefield, our enemy, of course, is the enemy of sin and death, defeated at the cross. And Israel's victory against the odds here, against 10,000 Moabites, points us to the most unexpected victory of all. You see, the economics of the gospel are always upside down. What to the world appears to be humiliating defeat is actually glorious triumph. 1 Corinthians 1:18, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. It's true, isn't it? Humanly speaking, there is nothing impressive about a carpenter hanging on a cross, dying a death in his early 30s with not much to shout about. There is nothing impressive about the church, about a group of people like us gathering to worship him. The world laughs at the foolishness of the gospel. But as the Apostle Paul continues to the believers in Corinth in the New Testament, God chose the foolish things of the world to shame the wise. God chose the weak things of the world to shame the strong, so that no one may boast. Because salvation is always by grace, and it is always and only from the Lord. So an undeserving people, an unlikely leader, and an unexpected victory. Here is a God who works in the mess to save his people, save you and me. But although Ehud and the judges who come after him, they all point us to Christ, none of them, it seems, can break the cycle of idolatry. They are all somehow flawed. And because they are human, they are finite. And so when they die, God's people fall back into sin and the cycle repeats. All of which is telling us that we need a ruler, a savior, who can break the cycle. Romans 3 tells us we're all under the power of sin. So we need a leader who has dealt with sin, who has conquered death. The judges couldn't make it last. But in Revelation chapter 1, Jesus, pictured in all his glory, says, I am the living one. I was dead, and now look, I am alive forever and ever. Jesus Christ is the Savior we need, because he alone has conquered death. And if we trust in him, our freedom from sin, our peace with God, will last forever. The rest that we enjoy when we turn to him can never be lost. Because in Jesus we have a ruler. We have a ruler right now this morning who is alive forever and ever. And out of the mess, in our pain, in our grief, when we get it wrong again, he saves us. Best news ever. Let's pray. Our gracious Father, as we hear your word to us this morning, we're conscious of the mess in our lives. And yet we thank you for this wonderful picture of a God who works in the mess. Father, we thank you that you come to an undeserving people like us. And in the Lord Jesus Christ, you have saved us from the enemy of sin and death. And Father, wherever we are this morning, whether we're familiar with these things and we've just lost the taste and grown a bit cold, or maybe it's all very, very new and we've never heard of the Lord Jesus Christ who died for us personally to save us, wherever we are this morning, would you, we pray, please, help us to respond in repentance and faith, that you might warm our hearts with your grace and your mercy in Jesus, the one who has saved us. In his name we pray. Amen.